not too long ago that I think has relevance to our gospel lesson. And I'll have to read some of this. Arriving at a Presbyterian church in Northern Ireland, Sohan was pleased to be greeted at the door by two women, church members, who seemed to invite her into conversation. Sohan realized that these women were ushers of some sort, whose job was to stand at the door of the church and interview newcomers as they arrived. They quietly asked her name and the first names of others approaching strangers who wished to join in the morning worship. Then Sohan figured out what was happening. Hearing those names, the ushers would draw conclusions about the cultural and religious identity of each. Those with Protestant names were welcomed warmly and shown to their seat. Those with apparently Catholic names like Maria's and Catherine's and Patrick's were told they were surely in the wrong church and sent on their way. I assume that someone might be referring to research that had been done decades ago in this church. My hope was quickly dashed. This remains the current practice, she said. This is a story that's foreign to North Americans, people like us, because it's about a faraway congregation of Irish Presbyterians who are nothing like us at all. They're still fighting the Protestant-Catholic battles. Luckily, we have no such issues. Our society has moved past such discriminatory behavior. We've elected an African-American president, and after all, knocked down all the walls and boundaries in our worship communities. Everyone is welcome. If we are to be honest about the church that we know, we have to confess that though we define our borders differently, we define them still, and maybe more subtly. We are curious about education and profession. In a church community like the ones that I know best, the higher level of education, the warmer the community is. And while none will be turned away, we will tell ourselves that we simply have more in common with those who are like us. In other communities, the query will vary from questions about neighborhoods that you lived in, or schools that you went to, or clubs that you belong to. These, after all, we understand the uneducated, the ones maybe not quite like us, truly might feel uncomfortable in our parish. With the less wealthy would feel uncomfortable in another. Is there a dominant social or political perspective that one really needs to be a subscriber to and that will prompt the community to be more open to newcomers? Is there a clarity about the norms for sexual identity or a family model that really must be established before the doors of the church are flung wide open to welcome? The gospel lesson today invites all of us to wrestle with these questions about the quality of the welcome that we offer to one another within the body of Christ, which we call the church. So our gospel lesson is clearly about welcome and hospitality, I think. Sure, you can talk about other things. In this end of the 10th chapter, we have a long series in that chapter about what it means to be a disciple and how hard it is. The chapter begins, chapter 10 begins, and he called to him his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits. And then it says the names of the 12, and he lists those. And he then instructs them on different things. He sent them out, go nowhere among the Gentiles, enter no town of the Samaritans. Behold, I send you out as a sheep in the midst of wolves, so be wise as a serpent and innocent as doves. As a disciple is not above his teacher. And then, so have no fear of them, for nothing is covered that will not be revealed or hidden. And do not think that I have come to bring peace on the earth. We remember all of those hard sayings. Then he ends that chapter. He who receives you receives me, or our translation. He who welcomes you welcomes me. And he who welcomes me welcomes him who sent me. Well, that's where this passage comes from. I know we take it out of context, but we have to remember where it fits in that teaching thing of the disciples. Let me try to take these few words of Jesus, which is part of his instructional teaching, and see some practical side to them. For me, this passage is all about welcoming or receiving others who come to us either through the doors of the church or outside of the church. I go back to what I said at the beginning. One of the lessons for us in Matthew 10, verses 40 through 42, is what kind of quality of welcome do we offer to one another in the body of Christ? Let me share with you some practical, tried and true methods about who will be coming to us. Those who will come to try us out. Those who will come to hear what we have to say or how we act. People who are seeking something new and something different. Most of us pride ourselves in being a very friendly group of people. And we need to do that. But we need more. We need much more than being just friendly at the door. And here's what I mean. We need a plan. We need a strategy. You all need a plan. You all need a strategy. Sure, we can say, well, we're small enough, we take care of people. Big churches have a bigger problem because they have a lot of people coming and visiting and they kind of go in and out. And so we all need a plan. Doesn't make any difference how big or how small you are. First, I think you need a person whose primary job is to seek out a visitor. Someone is always at that door besides an usher. Now, I know I'm telling you what to do, and I know some of y'all probably don't like to be told what to do, but I've learned that I is the bishop, and I can tell you what to do. Now, but you all are members of the congregation, and you don't have to listen to what I have to say. Have someone at the door who is seeking out visitors. They answer any questions a person may have. They try to get some information about them if they're willing to give it. And then make sure that they feel that they're welcome. And if there's a person that you think is maybe coming here, maybe for the first time, and they're not sure how to handle these three different books or two different books that we use in our worship, go go sit them down next to someone who knows what's going on in the service, and encourage them to participate. And going back to welcoming and having someone at the door, one of my dear friends was a lady named Val McWhorter. She was at St. George's in Gatesville, and she had a chair at the door that she sat at, and she was called the gatekeeper. And she was the gatekeeper. As you came in, she would greet you and welcome you, but she also played the cassette recorder for the music. But she really was the gatekeeper. So have someone there who will greet people. And then, after the service, have that person who is responsible for visitors go get that visitor and take them back there and introduce them around to your friends that you like and that you care so much about. Now that's a little work and that's a little effort. Be sure to get their information so a follow-up visit can be made by one of the lay leaders in the congregation. Encourage them to come back and tell them you'll be there to look for them. Make them feel special, important, just as Jesus says in our gospel passage. I was at a church in Ontario County, and it was not a big church, and I was standing at the door, and it was interesting. They gave out a parish survey because they were looking for a new rector, and everybody got a survey. I mean, the ushers of the vestry were pretty hard-nosed. If you came in, they stuck one in your hand. But there were three people who went out without them. So I jumped on them. I said, where's your survey? Why, how come you're not filling? We're visitors. I said, have you signed the guest book? Well, no, we don't know where it was. Did you fill out the card in the pew? Well, there wasn't one. And the people kind of were floundering around, not knowing what. They had three visitors, and they didn't know what to do with them. I thought, oh, come on, folks. We're trying to grow the church. So make them feel special. There's a lot more I could say on this subject. And our diocese will be offering some workshops on how to meet and greet visitors and how to incorporate them in our congregations, which is just as important. Once they come in, we need to make sure they find a place so they don't go out the revolving back door. Jesus' response to this kind of approach at the door is probably a bit surprising to those first hearers of the word, because they had a particular kind of person that they thought ought to worship with him. But what he was saying is take that love for family, your family, that love for your closest community, and extend it further and further and still further. Welcome in the stranger. Welcome in the one whose life you hardly understand. Not to change them, but simply because they too belong to God. Dare we preach that this is good news? Act as if it is what we are to do? We can only imagine that it is good news to those who have been previously shut out or rejected by the church and are giving the church another chance here. Those who in the past have been made to feel unwelcome. And I think the real good news is for those who have in the past guarded the door. Jesus insists that although we might pretend otherwise, we are not the gatekeepers of the community of God. We can bear that job no longer. Our work is to welcome, to offer an embrace when embrace is invited, and to give a cup of cool water on a hot summer day. Our reward, Jesus says, will be full indeed. How we treat others, how we welcome, how we receive others is a measure of our love of God. So think about a plan. Think about your strategy and get with it. Amen.